good morning. We're live here on Health Talk. Paul Thomas, Bill Kearney on Health Talk on AM 1270 and 96.5 KXBX. And Bill, you're without cane, you're without walker, without wheelchair. How do you heal so fast?
Well, I don't know that I have. I'm starting physical therapy next week, twice a week. I've just been doing it once a week, and I've still in a lot of pain, but I yesterday I actually got on the bicycle and rode the bicycle, which I didn't think I would do, and had a lot of pain after. I've been working about 2-3 hours a day, and that's really about all I can do. I was supposed to keep my leg elevated, but we got through Christmas and Thanksgiving, and now it's a new year coming up, and I missed both holidays pretty much with the pain and broken femur, and now we're hoping that this new year is kinder to us than
how many more bones do you have that you haven't broken?
My wife said this is the 8th surgery. Our anniversary is January 19th. We'll be married 43 years. She said this is the 8th major surgery since we've been married. And so we're hoping that those things kind of diminish in time. There aren't a whole lot of bones left.
That's what I was gonna say.
To 4 back surgeries and a shoulder and a rotator cuff and an ankle and a femur. So it's not as easy to heal as it was when I was much younger, but I'm not getting any younger, and I have to be in good physical shape, and that's part of the reason that I'm doing fairly well with this broken femur. Is I did have, because I swam every day, I was in fairly good shape, especially my legs. So a lot of muscle there to atrophy, if that so happens, and hopefully that won't happen. But we're here to talk about your health and a new year and lots of new things going on and lots of old things that still coming back to the surface. And the last study that came out yesterday, and I know you get tired of me hearing this, but because it's going to be a huge issue probably in this next campaign, this was just printed yesterday from some of Kaiser's information about, despite the name, the primary goal of the Affordable Health Care Act was to expand health care coverage to millions of Americans who had been uninsured. And while it did that, 15 million non-elderly adults have gained the coverage. Making that insurance affordable remains a significant challenge. So government subsidies that were supposed to be prevalent for people with incomes below 400% of the federal poverty level were designed to help with that, but rising premiums and high deductibles mean that getting health care coverage and treatment remains a financial burden for many Americans. So this new study from the Urban Institute shows just how high the toll can be related to two big problems for Obamacare: cost and confusion. And I think confusion is just a big a problem as the cost. But the study had found that the median single enrollee earning between $35,310 and $47,080, or a family of four earning between $72,000 and $97,000. Now, these aren't small amounts to be making as an annual income. We'll spend almost 15% of their income next year on Obamacare insurance premiums and out-of-pocket costs in 2016, even with the subsidy. So the percentages increase for those with worsening health and those over the age of 45, and 10% of the people in the income range. The Urban Institute researchers looked at between 200% and 500% of the federal poverty level will spend more than 21% of their income on health care costs. Almost a fourth of your income now on health care costs. So there isn't any objective standard for how much people should spend on health care, and a lot of people make the judgment that it's just unaffordable, and that makes a real impact. But a senior research institute, one of the senior researchers found that the cost is the main reason that the uninsured give for why they lack coverage. They become a threat to the overall Obamacare program. The affordability of the marketplace premiums and out-of-pocket limits need to be further addressed to reduce the risk of the enrollment and reductions in the number of insured will be well below what the objectives were when they passed the law. Remember, the law was passed with don't read it now, read it after it's been passed, and we'll understand that several thousand pages. The health care law created penalties if you didn't sign up, and those fees rise this year and will climb again next year. And as I've told many of you, as soon as the president goes out of office, a lot of these price increases will continue to accelerate. But once the penalties flatten, the cost of health care continues getting growing. More people will face the financial pressure to drop out of the exchange because it's going to be a gradual decrease in enrollment, and the way that was designed would be a gradual increase in enrollment. Some progress has been made toward making it more affordable, though, and the Urban Institute report found that 17.3% of non-elderly adults said they had problems paying their medical bills in 2015. That was down from 22% in 2013, so almost 18%. Of course, those health care costs are just limited to those covered by Obamacare. People with employer-based plans are also going to see larger premiums and out-of-the-pocket costs next year. And I'm one of those as an independent employer in the county of Lake, and I have seen those insurance costs raise substantially. According to an analyst from the Employee Benefit Group, the combined premium and out-of-pocket costs for employees are going to be more than $5,000 for the first time this year, next year. So workers who make $50,000 or less annually, that means health care costs will account for about 10% of their income. But in general, those with employer-based plans, especially for plans offered by large employers, they will be lower than those with Obamacare. And I can say for my employees that that is true. They are going to be lower, but it's still quite an amount of money for us to take care of our health care costs. And I have been a recipient of that emergency-type care, and those things will all be going on my end of the year and beginning of next year deductibles for some of these health care costs. And believe me, it's substantial. Even if you're on Medicare and you have a supplemental plan that picks up where Medicare drops off, there still is a bit for you to pick up as an individual with insurance. So we need to save money wherever we can. And there was an article. Again, our number is 263-5252. Any questions about anything we're talking about? You want to give us a call? We'll be more than happy to try to answer them for you. I've been a little inactive in the past month, so I may not be as sharp as a tack, but I'll be sharp enough to get Paul to answer the questions if I can't. So 263-5252. But we have to try to save money wherever we can. And one of the places that has been a red flag in consumer costs this year has been drug prices. And you need to save money on meds where you can. Consumer Reports just came out with a report this week about how much drugs were going to cost and how to find the best deal possible. And a lot of high drug costs went into effect last year. And a third of those who currently take a drug said they experienced a very high price spike in the past 12 months, anywhere from just a few dollars to more than $100 a prescription. And according to the American Society of Health System Pharmacists, big price jumps can be due to anything from a product shortage to a change in your insurance coverage. And in rare instances, manufacturers may raise prices simply because They have no competition. And if you remember just before our last show, the individual that had raised the price of Daraprim, this anti-malarial drug and HIV drug, to 5,000% more than it was before, a young entrepreneur was arrested for, I think, inside trading, or do you remember what it was, Paul?
Ponzi scheme.
What was it?
Like a Ponzi scheme, right?
Yeah, a Ponzi scheme. So he's under arrest for that, and he's no longer CEO of that company. So the government is looking at those things and seeing what they can do. Most people have just gone ahead and paid for the prescriptions, even though they've gone up, and they've not questioned why they have, because they don't know that they have a choice. Drugs could cost as much as 10 times more at one retailer than it did another. And we're talking about regional differences. We found big variances at retailers in the same area. For example, there was a gal in Raleigh, North Carolina. The cost of a drug for a month's worth of generic Cymbalta ranged from $249 at Walgreens to $43 at another chain. The pharmacist did suggest using the store's discount program to lower the price to $220, but it comes with a $20 annual fee. So the price isn't always set in stone. Sometimes they found that they could get a discount by just asking the pharmacy. It sounds crazy that you would need to approach buying prescription medications like you would in a flea market or something, but shopping around and haggling, but that's really part of today's marketplace. Retail pharmacies don't really expect anyone to pay those high prices, especially the chains. And the prices are a lot, and they are much because chains such as CVS and Rite Aid and set a real high retail list or usual and customary prices, because that helps determine whether the insurance companies will help pay for the drug. Still, those huge discrepancies are puzzling, as with other consumer products such as toothpaste and cereal. We'd expect prices to be more consistent among stores competing for your business. But although chains have their own contracts with drug suppliers, it's usually according to the wholesale price that would be very likely widely competitive. So they reached out to consumers to a few retailers, but they would not comment on why the wild swings that we've been seeing. So, and of course, the wild swings come from major competitors, such as the chains. They earlier this last year, this past year, they had consumers make calls to pharmacies in more than 200 pharmacies across the country to price a market basket of five generic prescription drugs. And then they followed up with half of them recently and also checked online pharmacy to get the most up-to-date prices. The number in the chart, the charts are averages of what they paid. You don't have the chart, but I do. One of the things that they found out in getting the best deal, this might really kind of surprise you, but the number one strategy for savings, and this doesn't come from me, this is Consumer Reports. Skip chain drugstores. For all but the five drugs, the big pharmacy chains consistently charge the most. Among all the walk-in stores, Costco was the least, except for independent pharmacies. You don't need to be a member to go into the Costco system. Their number two savings report was support independent pharmacies. Though you might think that the mom-and-pop stores usually charge higher prices, consumers found that that wasn't always the case. In fact, we found some real bargains at local independent pharmacies, as well as some higher prices, of course, because of the variedness of independent pharmacies. They also found out wild fluctuations at supermarkets, another place you might suspect to save. Another advantage of the independents was they often had luck asking for a lower price, where pharmacies might have more flexibility to match or beat a competitor's price. We have a consumer savings plan that we detail for anybody that comes in. If it's not covered on your formulary, we cover it through our savings plan at a discount. So that's always available. And always ask for the lowest price. Some of the people might be shocked at what you ask for, but things are changing and we have to change with them. So, and if you can get a 90-day prescriptions, and you wonder many times why independent pharmacies can't do that, and that's because the big chains that have pharmacy benefit managers like CVS and Caremark and Express Scripts don't allow the independents to give the same kind of price that they allow the chains to do. So, for instance, if you'll pay one copay rather than three, and for the discount generic programs, paying $10 for a 90-day supply works out to be less than $4 every 30 days. So, and you can look online, but you have to be very careful when you look online and make sure that it's a reputable company. I still think your best bet, as you would expect from me, is to stay independent. The other thing is, one of the things that you need to do is stay with one pharmacy. So as frustrating as these price hikes can be, most people just fork over the money right now. That's going to change because of the cost of these things, and people will be changing pharmacies. And the pharmacy that can give you the most service, and we assure you that we fit into that category, and plus being able to deliver your prescriptions to you. And but you have to give us all your prescriptions. We have to know everything you're taking, because we can't be the watchdog over drug interactions with the kind of medicines you're taking if you don't let us know everything you're taking, including generics and over-the-counter things and natural products, which are herbal products. So lots of tips for trying to do better for buying those prescriptions, and that prescription has become one of the most expensive costs that you have to your healthcare system. And remember, we're taking a lot of drugs that we weren't taking years ago. The five drugs that they checked was generic Actos, generic Cymbalta, generic Lipitor, Plavix, and Singulair. And those are very high volume medications. And again, what they found out were the chains were the highest on those. Independents were the most competitive. And they checked independents, Costco, Sam's Club, Target, Walmart, Kmart, grocery stores, Walgreens, and Rite Aid and CVS. And the highest are our own competitors in our towns here. So just giving you an idea of how you can save money in the future. It doesn't cost you a thing to come in and say, how much would this drug cost me here? We have to run it through as cash because we don't have your insurance information. But if we run it through your insurance, we can give you some idea on what the copay is. And then if we have to reverse it, we can. So I want to remind everybody, this is, what, is this the 30th today?
Today is the 30th.
This is the next to the last day of this year. If you've met your Medicare or Medi-Cal deductible and you haven't gotten your flu shot, or and your Medicare, if you haven't got your pneumonia shot, or Zostavax. Some Medicare Ds pay for Zostavax, which is your shingle shot. And we're going to talk about that that shingles in a little bit. You need to get them now. If you wait until January 1, you're going to have to meet your deductible again, even for a flu shot, which is free right now. And same way with your Medi-Cal. If you have a share of cost and you've already met it, get your flu shot. We haven't really got into the flu weather yet. It's starting to work its way into California. And I'm sure you've talked to several people who've had it besides a Nova virus is coming again and causing a lot of people in the Bay Area and Marin County. It's working north to the norovirus to contaminate a lot of people. So I heard yesterday on the news they called it the throw-up virus. So nice. None of us really want to do that. So we're going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to talk about some new and upcoming things in healthcare and some of the things you're going to have to watch out for in the future. Many patients with chronic pain end up taking pain medications from many different physicians. Hi, my name is Bill Kearney, pharmacist and owner of Northlake Medical Pharmacies. Each of your doctors may not be aware of the medications prescribed by other doctors. The result is an increase of side effects that don't necessarily come from better pain control. The drugs are usually prescribed for pain and for a short amount of time, but the length of time can get lost in the shuffle. If you're taking multiple medications, sit down with your pharmacist and review all of them. Not just pain medications, but all your medications. Ask about our medication review program where you bring all your medications into our pharmacist. We will look at all the medications, both prescriptions and over-the-counter, to check for duplications, expired medications, and possibly discontinued meds. There are no charges for this service. It's a free service, and you don't have to be our customers. Northlake Medical Pharmacies with two locations for you, at Hill Road next to Sutter Lakeside Hospital and outside the Bruno ShopSmart in Lakeport.
Out on the golf course, there are the obvious hazards. There's the pond, the bunker, the rough, the even rougher.
Yeah, put me down for an eight.
The giant maples. The row of houses out of bounds on the right. The angry flock of geese who've surrounded your ball. Even the occasional groundskeeper you had no clue was there. But if you think you found every possible hazard out there, think again. The hazard you missed could actually be a killer. It's the spot on your skin, the one that could be skin cancer. Fact is, if you're a man over 50, you're in a group most likely to develop skin cancer, including melanoma, the kind that kills one person every hour. One in five Americans is likely to develop a form of skin cancer during their lifetime. That's why your best shot is to check for a spot. It's easy. Follow through and check your skin. It could be the save of a lifetime. Go to spotskincancer.org to find out how. A message from the American Academy of Dermatology.
Attention savers. This important message will change how you save. The Treasury Department is eliminating paper savings bonds from the payroll savings program and going green with Treasury Direct. Treasury Direct is a convenient, secure online savings program that makes it simple for you to purchase electronic savings bonds directly from your paycheck, checking, or savings account. So go online and change how you save today. Visit treasurydirect.gov to open your free account.
A public service message from the Department of the Treasury.
A single ember from a wildfire can travel over a mile. It can ignite and destroy your home and even your community. To that ember, all those branches hanging over your roof might as well be giant matchsticks ready to spark. The pile of dry leaves and twigs clogging your gutters are the perfect kindling to start a fire. And all those debris piles and brush around your yard, which you haven't taken care of yet, are pure lighter fluid, ready to ignite. There are some fire hazards that aren't clearly marked, and they can impact you and your neighbors. Learn to spot them, because your home is better protected from wildfire damage when your whole community is prepared. Visit fireadapted.org for more tips on how to get started adapting your home and community to wildfires. A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
Okay, we're back.
Well, we're back, and we were talking about, I said novavirus, it's norovirus, and I was looking in the record B today, and because I had heard them talk about it last night on the national news, about how contagious this was in California, and for some reason, the Marin County public health officer, and he was on television last night, was talking about six of the 32 outbreaks over the period from October 1st on, and he said two or more cases in a single facility within a 24-hour period is an official outbreak. So they typically see 15 to 20 norovirus outbreaks in Marin County each year, and it's getting to be more. Due to the seasonal nature, norovirus is sometimes referred to as winter vomiting. I said throw up. This is a little more. There have been two outbreaks in Marin this month, one on December 15th at the Novato Youth Center. And he said, they asked him, what could we do to prevent it and keep it from spreading? And he said, most all the outbreaks occur because they're not. You're not washing your hands after being at the bathroom or prior to cooking. And most of the outbreaks occur during the winter when their people are kind of enclosed. And they must be vigilant about hand washing and cleaning contaminated surfaces. The virus could be present in both the stool and the vomit of sick people. So it can occur through direct contact with another person who's ill or by eating food or drinking liquids contaminated with the virus or by touching contaminated surface or touching one's mouth. So hopefully this doesn't become a huge epidemic and end up being a new health problem in California.
Bill, have you heard much about people getting the flu? And it kind of just keeps recycling around. We seem to have that going on in my family where...
That happened last year, Paul, a lot. You know, yeah. You'd get over it, and 6 weeks later, you would have it again.
Or even sooner, you know, or somebody else in the family has it right after you, and then they get well, and then somebody else has it, and then it comes back around to you again.
And it's usually, I don't know that it's the flu, but it's a virus, and it doesn't respond to antibiotics very well. But after it's gone around a couple of times, you end up getting a bacterial infection, and it has that cough with it. And that cough, of course, spreads all over. And we're hoping that that doesn't happen with this flu. Last year, the flu vaccine was only 19% effective. This year, they figure 76 to 78% effective. So we're hoping that it's not flu-related. And, of course, there's hundreds of viruses that cause a cold. Normally, you don't have a fever, but you do have the cough. And many times that cough will develop into a bronchitis type thing and then a lung infection. So we need to be really careful about and I think in any kind of a disease that's transmittable that way, washing your hands completely or using an alcohol type disinfectant would help a lot, and do anything you could to keep it from transmitting from one place to the other, because a lot of these things are transmittable without much effort, and people are wondering where it's coming from. If you've noticed, a lot of people lately, especially during the winter season, their eyes are itching, and you wonder why they get so dry, especially during the winter, and how do you keep them moist. In your home, the air is dry, and over-the-counter preservative artificial tears work lots of times at nighttime. At bedtime, it's worse, and you use a gel to put them on so they stay on. If you wear soft contact lenses, sometimes you need to take them off at night. If dryness is chronic and bothersome, this Restasis, which helps keep your eyes moist, can help, but it may take several weeks to work. In some studies, these omega-3 fatty acids taken orally make the natural tears that lubricate eyes last longer, but more research is needed to see how much of the nutrient is useful for dry eyes. But I've noticed in our own house, and because you have the heat going more, that it dries the moisture up and your eyes dry up accordingly. So be aware that it's the time of the year as well. People that take statins, and we talk about statins all the time because it helps lower cholesterol, sometimes get a myopathy, which is a muscle pain. And overall, statins are safe but can cause side effects in up to 10% of the users even after a long-term use. Your doctor right away needs to see you if you have unexplained pain or fatigue, vomiting, dark urine, appetite loss. To ease side effect, your doctor can switch your statin or adjust the dose. Make sure that your physician knows all the medications you use, include over-the-counter drugs and supplements. Grapefruit juice can increase the risk of side effects, and a lot of people wonder why. And I've answered that question a lot, but probably not nearly enough. Despite claims on the internet, the supplement CoQ10 won't really prevent statin-induced muscle pain. The muscle pain is called a myopathy, and it could be severe if you let it go. And if they don't do something about the muscle pain and it gets chronic, it could be hard to correct. It's much easier to correct if you get off of it early. You need to let your physicians know difficult it is, and it is one of those kind of muscle pains that just doesn't go away. It could be as cumbersome as trying to get it in and out of a bathtub, and you can't do it. Has a tendency to get worse if it's statin-caused. So what you need to do is talk to your physician about it, and like they say, many times you can just change from one statin to another. You may be on atorvastatin, which is Lipitor, and go to simvastatin do much better, or pravastatin. So despite claims that other things can help you, it usually takes switching that statin. And as we're talking about uncomfortable things with medication, there's a lot of people that hate getting shots because it hurts. And some shots do hurt. Researchers show that relaxation techniques such as minutes of slow, deep breathing with your eyes closed can help reduce pain and anxiety. And I'll tell you why that is. When you're very chronic or very upset or very stressed out about getting a shot, your blood vessels constrict. And we are putting most of the time either that shot is subcutaneous underneath the skin or it is into the muscle. And both times, if you're tense, those blood vessels do not allow the fluid to diffuse through your system like they would otherwise. And so that vaccine builds up in those blood vessels, just like if you have a blockage in your heart and you have what we call angina, which is chest pain, because the blood is trying to go through faster, pump through there faster than your veins will take it. The same thing happens when you're getting a shot. We're trying to have you relax and get the vaccine into your bloodstream while you're relaxed. And if you're tensed, it's making us push that through. And when we try to push that through, it hurts. And it hurts afterwards, too. So just be aware that if you can relax, many times I just had a gentleman yesterday and I said, relax. And he didn't, and I said, come on, relax. Finally, he took a deep breath and relaxed, and it was just fine. So another thing that people have asked.
He was afraid of a shot?
Yeah, he. He. I mean, he didn't say he was afraid of the shot. He's had him before, but I could just.
Tense up.
He was a muscular guy, and he was a contractor, and you know, just that fight or flight mechanism. You know, you tense up if something's going to attack you, and. Once I got him, and I just kind of slapped him on the shoulder, and I says, come on, relax. And he did, just took a deep breath, and you could just feel the tissue around where you gave the shot relax, and it went right in, you know.
Big muscular bodybuilder guy.
And a lot of times they're just the opposite. They have tiny arms and limbs, and there's not much there, so you can't even push an inch needle in all the way, or you'll hit bone, you know. So you try to extend it out. You need to get it in at least a half an inch.
And then there's guys like me whose muscles hang down below. Like
yeah.
The old Popeye commercial you know, the old cartoon where it makes like a U.
Yeah. Well, we can usually pretty safely immunize a guy like you. But no, you're not that bad.
I'm not that bad.
Also, you have seen, and especially these new paint-on toenail commercials, and it's $300 or $400 for one of these things. And before you try to paint on a prescription medication, make sure you truly have a toenail fungus, which can leave nails thick and discolored and misshapen, and in some cases looks like toenail fungus is actually a nail injury. And you can do it up to 54 weeks. I mean, it takes a long time to build that nail up. For this Jublia, this new one is around $300. Cleared up infections for 6.5% to 18% of the users. Eased the problem by at least 90%.
It only cleaned up 6.5%?
For 6.5% to 18% of the users, and ease the problem by at least 90% for 15% and 26%. So,
really, not that much, yeah.
The older paint on drug application, which was called Penlac and generic, cleans up about half that much. So, oral prescriptions, antifungals, cure up to 66% of the infections after 12 weeks, but can cause some digestive comfort. So I would far rather take the pills and do it for 3 months than do it for a year, 54 weeks, and get about 6.5% to 18%. So when you see these commercials, and they're spending a lot of money on commercials for these new things, just be aware that they can cause a lot of unnecessary maintenance that you probably aren't going to be compliant over 54 weeks. Are you going to paint your toes every night? Unless you're
in a
Broadway show.
Yeah, I already do.
Yeah, Paul does already. So,
the colors of the rainbow.
I have four little points here about four ways to keep the germs at bay for the norovirus. And wash your hands correctly, and it won't strengthen your immune system, but it will reduce germs on your hands, so you're less likely to transfer. The best way to wash them is over a period of time. I forget the song we used to have to sing to wash your hands over a period of time. And if water isn't available, use one of those sanitizers such as Purell. Has to be at least 60% alcohol to be effective against the germs. This is the one that I find difficult. Don't touch your face. Most of us touch our eyes, nose, and mouth about 16 times over the course of 3 hours. That lays down a welcome mat for bacteria, viruses, and other bugs that hang out on your hands. And especially with computers, we're on computers all the time, and we're taking the computers, and then we're rubbing our eyes, and next thing you know. And then the last thing, of course, is just get your shots and make sure that we're your due. You take them. Use your antibiotics wisely, and that means don't use those antibiotics if, in fact, you don't have a virus present and you're looking at other ways to cure something. Many times, natural substances, just taking care of yourself. I got a book, and I can't remember who the writer is. In fact, one of my daughters and one of my daughter-in-laws got me this same book, and it's about using some natural substances for curing immune diseases and things. And I'm going to start reading it and sharing it with people. More about shingles, more about getting prompt care. Prevention is the best thing you can do, and the vaccine is recommended by the Centers for Disease Control. Even recommended if you've had an episode of shingles in the past, shingles can reoccur. So it reduces the risk of developing it by 30%. If you do get shingles, it reduces the risk of developing the chronic post-herpetic neuralgia by 67%. Still, it's estimated that only 24% of adults 60 or older have received the vaccine. So do the best you can. It is pricey. It's around $200. If you're over 60, a lot of your Medicare D plans pay for it. At least come in and try. You don't need a prescription. We have a collateral agreement with physicians that allow us to give you the immunization without a prescription from a physician. And please don't let the opportunity go by that you don't take care of that. You've seen these ads about Eliquis and some of these non-blood clotting like warfarin that will keep your blood thinner so you don't have to have a heart attack or a stroke. The Food and Drug Administration recently approved a new drug, which is one of the newer blood thinners, and it neutralizes the effects of some of these drugs within minutes. Researchers are being testing potential antidotes for reversals other than oral coagulant. So Eliquis and Xarelto work a bit differently. Those blood thinners seem to make users bleed more easily. One of the problems with that is, though, you can't stop the bleeding as well as you can with Coumadin or warfarin. If you listen to the ads, they say it's more easily controlled. But all blood thinners tend to make users bleed more easily, but the overall risk of serious bleeding is low. The newer blood thinners have advantages over warfarin because they require less laboratory monitoring. So slight bleeding can generally be managed with conservative measures. Applying pressure by a small cut is usually enough to make the bleeding stop. It's when you're having surgery that they're most concerned that you would get a bleeder. And when I was having surgery for my femur, the anesthesiologist came in who I knew personally, and he says, "Bill, did you take your Celebrex this morning, which is a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory?" And I said, "Yes, I did, Fred." And he says, "You're a pharmacist. You know better than that. That's non-steroidals cause bleeding." And I says, "Well, the last time I was in here for another broken bone, I had done the same thing, and you had the lab test me, and so we ran a blood test to make sure my blood would clot easily." And it did, and he's right. Somehow, when you're going under the knife, you don't think as clearly as you would think otherwise. And those things just didn't seem to be important. I had broke my femur on a Friday, and I didn't have surgery till a Tuesday. So I was laying there in pain at home for several days, and I when I was first admitted to the hospital, I had already taken all my morning medications. So shame on me. And you need to be aware of these, especially blood thinners when you're doing it, because slight bleeding can generally be managed. But when you go into a surgery or other invasive procedure scheduled, your doctor will probably recommend that the blood thinner be discontinued for several days beforehand. And usually for me, it's about 5 days. And I am in so much pain without taking an anti-inflammatory, I usually cut it to about 2 days. But in an emergency with uncontrolled bleeding, they include discontinuing the anticoagulant, addressing the source of the bleeding, administering blood transfusions if needed, and using therapies such as prothrombin to help arrest the bleeding. So there are things you can do, excuse me, but it's not nearly as effective with these non-Coumadin drugs as it is with warfarin or Coumadin. So you need to be aware that that's eventually going to be a problem. If it doesn't get you the first time, it will eventually get you in another time of need. The last thing I want to talk about for a minute are taking antidepressants. And I had this come up, and it usually comes up during the holidays. Somebody didn't get their antidepressant filled, a serotonin reuptake inhibitor, an SSRI, before New Year's, or before Christmas. Their doctor wasn't in only a selected amount of time between Christmas and New Year's. Excuse me. And they ran out. If you're on an antidepressant like that, and you ran out, and you'll probably notice it in 24 hours with a headache or some sort of a reaction, and then as time goes on, the reaction will get more severe, and all of a sudden you will feel like your whole body's falling apart. And nothing bizarre, you may be vomiting, but I doubt it. You just feel like everything's wrong, and you feel it within yourself, and you're blaming yourself because you don't know why you feel so bad, and it's actually withdrawal from that antidepressant. So don't ever go without that antidepressant. If you're one of our patients and you came in Christmas Eve or Christmas Day or the next day we were open and said you were out of it, your doctor wouldn't be in for a week. We would give you enough to get you by and get you back your serotonin level back up to where it should be. So please don't try to do that with almost any medication. Antibiotics is one you can probably do it with. Another drug that you may not think about that's difficult for people to get off of without having side effects are PPIs, these proton pump inhibitors that you take for heartburn. And immediately the heartburn will come back. Even though you're not sure that you really had it before. So you need to taper off those things slowly. And don't go through a tapering process without talking to your doctor or pharmacist. And even if you talk to your pharmacist, we will highly suggest that you talk to your physician before you start the tapering the dose. These are powerful drugs. Even though some of them are over-the-counter medications, they're powerful, and they must be adhered to taking them properly. And even though they're over-the-counter, your pharmacist and physician must know what you're putting into your system so you're not overdoing it. But antidepressants is a huge thing to be without. Some blood pressure medications can do the same way. Simvastatins and atorvastatin sometimes can cause an immediate a stroke by getting off of them. Not highly probable, but possible. And it's something you just need to be very, very careful of. We used to have, years ago, physicians would say, especially cardiologists back in the old days, would say, you know, you don't need this blood pressure medication anymore, or you don't need this blood thinner anymore. You don't need this beta blocker anymore. Stop taking it. And they would cold turkey people off of them. and they would have side effects. And for a long time, we didn't realize, because people weren't getting high, they were just having the brain perform a function that, with the aid of the medication, that that normally a healthy body would perform. And maybe the body was up to the point that it could perform it, but we were enhancing that performance by taking the medication. So we just need to be really careful. You can't be too cautious about taking the medication. And when in doubt, take it until you can get a hold of your physician, unless you feel like it's a duplicate medication or the pharmacy gave you the wrong medication, at which time call the pharmacy up. You know, the law now requires us to have on the outside of the bottle what the pill looks like, who the company is that made it, what the identification marks are for on the outside, and the color of it. So those things, if you read it that to us, we can clearly look it up. And even if we're home, we can get on our computer and verify that that's what you have. So this year, we're going to start thinking about taking care of ourselves more completely than we have in the past, not only for the price of the medication that we're having, but that it's the right medication and we're taking it right. We're asking the right kind of questions when we have the medication given to us by a doctor. How long do we have to take it? What's it supposed to do? Is this something I have to take for the rest of my life? If it's a disease that you don't know about, what are the symptoms of the disease and what am I supposed to look for if I'm getting better or worse? Too often with medication, we don't know if we're treating a temporary thing or a more permanent thing. And we have to be aware to at least, is that our music?
That's that is, yeah.
Oh, I have to remind everybody that our show is going over. Have a very happy new year. It's North Lake Medical Pharmacy with two locations for you at 5136 Hill Road East across from Sutter Lakeside Hospital. Call us there at 263-6192 or outside the Bruno Shop Smart at 347 Lakeport Boulevard. Call us there at 263-1328. Thank you, Paul, and happy new year.
Yeah, Bill, and we'll see everybody back here again next Wednesday for Health Talk on AM 1270 and 96.5 FM KXVX.